Okay, thank you very much for inviting me here. I did speak to Engineers Ireland once before, probably maybe 4 years ago, I don't know, 3 years ago, and I was I had a co-speaker, Krahora Brody, who is now a professor of composites at the University of Edinburgh. So I just really wanted to update you on the sorts of progress we've been making in IComp. Just to go back, we now have three what we call research providing organisations in IComp. So we're hosted at the University of Limerick. UCD has always been one of our partners, but we now have AIT, Athlone Institute of Technology, who's a third RPO with IComp. I should tell you that I've worked in industry all my life, so I'm not speaking to you as an academic. This is a very applied sort of presentation. So the ICOMP mission is to harness the best national and international science and technology in order to ensure that Ireland benefits from the burgeoning global composites market, to create jobs and develop the industrial base, address current problems and aspirations identified by Irish industry, connect Irish companies nationally and internationally, develop longer-term strategies which will lead to new higher added value products, processes, etc. for Irish industry, facilitate innovation to create IP, spin out companies and opportunities for entrepreneurs, and establish Ireland as a significant international player in the science and technology of composites. So when I spoke to you last, I think we probably had 8 or possibly 10 industrial members. We now have 26 industrial members from across the whole of Ireland, and these range from companies in the supply chain right through to the major end users such as Bombardier BAE Aerospace, who are the biggest manufacturer of aircraft seating in the world, who are up in Kilkeel. And there's a whole range of other companies in between. So we now moved into ICOMP phase two. We had 5 years funding from Enterprise Ireland, starting from 2010, went up to 2015. We now have another 5 years funding going up to 2020. We now have various requirements that we've agreed with Enterprise Ireland. So we have to reach what's called financial triangulation by 2020, which means that we have to match the funds that Enterprise Ireland are making available to us with an equal amount from industry and an equal amount from leveraged funding from, for example, Horizon 2020 and such like. So that's a major challenge for us. We have to increase our industrial membership to 50 by 2020, and we have to work with new sectors, including, for example, agricultural equipment. There's a big industry in Ireland manufacturing agricultural equipment, and I'm sure that a lot of them are not fully aware of the benefits of using composites. The construction industry, which I will touch on a bit later on, but this is a major sector for the rapidly developing use of composite materials, and also medical devices, which obviously is a big industry in Ireland. We want to establish cross-border collaborations with NIAS in Belfast. I think this is very important for us to be working together with NIAS. We have to participate in Horizon 2020 and European Space Agency projects. And so the very good news is that Limerick, University of Limerick, has recently appointed a chair in composite materials. This is an SFI chair in composite materials, and this is going to be one of the Burnell chairs. And this is a fantastic development for the whole of the composite sector across Ireland. We're now moving into new accommodation at Limerick. This is in an extension to the MSSI building, and and also the Burnell building, which is they're joined together. So we're moving all our equipment and everything, so we'll have a proper focused centre in the University of Limerick. And I have to say that the university have been incredibly supportive and helpful in establishing this centre. So this is the new building, and we're going to be located in there. So just to tell you a little bit about where we are today with composites. If you go back to the first aeroplanes, these were essentially composite aeroplanes. They were made out of calico, which was painted with dope to make it weatherproof and stiff, and they were built on wooden structures. So essentially the first planes were made out of composite. But then we've now gone to the very top end of the composites industry with, you see here, there's the Boeing 787, which is 52% by weight of composite. That's the sort of bright blue plane in the middle there. To the right of it, there's the Airbus A350, which is also about 50% by weight of composites. The big plane down the bottom here is the Airbus A380, which is 23% by weight of composite. And then at the bottom right, we have the Bombardier C-Series plane, which has got, among other parts, it has composite wings. And we've arrived at this position via all sorts of structures. So, I think what I can say is that if ever you fly on any of these planes, you can be absolutely sure that the composite materials have been tested to death in, for example, Formula One cars, high-performance road cars, and all these military applications, the F-22, the F-32, the space program, etc. So everything is, I would say, absolutely ultra safe on these civil aircraft. But now we move forward from there. Almost like a revolution by Boeing in launching the 787 has really opened up the world of composites to all sorts of other industries. So we're now finding use in many other applications where legislation and the requirement for a low carbon energy future is driving people towards lightweight structures. So we have, for example, the Dragon Bridge in North Wales, which starts off as this sort of butterfly structure and then opens out to actually form the bridge. Natural gas tanks, there's a massive industry developing in natural gas, both from fracking and also from biogases, etc. And there's a great requirement across the world for tanks, very lightweight composite tanks that can be used for both storage and transportation of these gases, but also on a whole range of vehicles, especially in the United States, where they're looking very much towards using the gas from fracking towards driving almost all of their land transportation. And then we have, for example, the BMW electric vehicle, which is essentially a composite. At least composites are a major component in this vehicle. And then, and these are just some of the composite structures made in Ireland. So we have BA Aerospace manufacturing aircraft seats. We have Wright Bus, who are manufacturing these London buses. We have Aero Composites over in Galway, manufacturing wind turbine blades. We have a company called Swift, who are now manufacturing an electric vehicle, electric car, which is essentially, in the short term, is for the London market, like the high end of the sort of fashionable people, if you like, who can afford these sort of vehicles. And then, rather more basic, the green picture on the end of it is of a composite manhole cover. So that these are just some of the areas that composites are being used in Ireland. This is a picture of the global composites growth forecasts. So you see we've got the usual aerospace and defence, where we're talking about by 2020 a global market of $20 billion. We have other transportation, ground transportation, with a market of $15 billion. Construction, $14 billion. Marine, energy, and so on. So the whole market forecast by 2015 was $75 billion. And it's obviously going to be much more than that by 2020. And there are opportunities for composites in Ireland, civil aircraft and space, automotive and electric vehicles, buses, lorries, agricultural vehicles and off-the-road vehicles, wind and water turbines, manufacture and maintenance of these, construction, building and infrastructure, pipes and tanks for applications such as offshore oil and gas, and also storage, as I've mentioned, supply chain, materials, adhesives, coatings, natural fibres, recycling of materials. Then there's opportunities in damage detection and repair. As the composite market grows, so the damage of composite structures and the wear of composite structures grow, so therefore there's a requirement to actually repair these and maintain them. And then there's opportunities for engineering in design, tooling, processing equipment, machining, cutting, drilling, fastening, etc. And IComp industrial members are currently developing a vision and a strategy for Ireland for the way forward in composites. You know, the previous slide I showed you with the different market sectors and so on, you know, in the UK, for example, they have a similar slide to that showing where we are now or where they are now and where they proposal will be in say 10 years time, and we really need to put something together like that for Ireland. It's quite difficult to gather the necessary data on the current situation in Ireland and what the potential is. So but the industrial members are endeavouring to sort of put this picture together for the whole of Ireland. So this is some of the equipment we have in IComp. We have a 400 degree centigrade autoclave. We have a high precision hydraulic press. We have industry standard resin transfer molding equipment. We have a laser heated automated toe placement machine. And we have, again, an RTM press, which is the industry standard comprehensive range of characterization and testing equipment. At UCD, we have various, like a thermoclave for making small composite test panels. They have a 3 and 5 axis machine centers and a CNC lathe, plus a load of equipment for testing structures, testing adhesives, and very importantly, surface characterization equipment. Also at UCD, they have this surface engineer equipment, which essentially is plasma treatment, which can be used for surface activation, cleaning, and deposition of functional coatings. So we also have equipment at AIT, but AIT have only just become a member of IComp, so I don't really have any slides on their equipment. But AIT specialise in thermoplastic materials and the processing and characterisation of thermoplastics. So some of the IComp successes over the last three or four years. First of all, for example, we have a company called Bergman Packings who manufacture these braidings, and we have a Scott Bader who supply resins. And so those two companies came together with Global Green Composites in County Mead to develop these lightweight, this sort of lightweight ladder type of structure, but also various other rails and hollow composite tubing parts. And last year they won this award at the light rail industry exhibition in the UK for their for these lightweight materials. And this is the this is what they call the Mighty Bar, and this the quotation from their award ceremony was: "The Mighty Bar uses the latest composites technology to offer this weight reduction, but also something that is more practical and more attractive than steel or aluminium. It's non-slip, warm for the touch and never needs painting. So it's a deserving winner for the fact that it can be used on doors, station platforms and stairways as well. In fact, it's pretty much anywhere in the passenger environment. So these sort of materials have actually got a lot of future across a whole range of not just the transport sector, but other sectors as well. So that was a great plus for Global Green and Bergman and Scott Bader. These sort of tubings, hollow tubes, composite tubes, can be used in things like aircraft seating on buses. I believe that the Wright bus used something like 10 kilometres a year of steel tubing on their buses, and these sort of hollow tubes, composite tubes, can be used to replace that, giving weight reductions, which are very important for reducing emissions to meet the European legislation and so on. And then, obviously, on cars, like, for example, the BMW car there, the electric vehicle, the whole sort of cage that it's built around is actually made out of braided tubing, composite tubing. So in those sort of applications, these materials have got a great future. So this is a composite manhole cover that we developed in partnership with one of our companies. When I was first asked about composite manhole covers, I couldn't believe that anybody would actually want to use them. But when you start to look at the industry, you see that it's actually a massive industry replacing steel with composite. There are all sorts of advantages in using composite. I mean, one big advantage when we started this work about 3 years ago was that steel was so expensive that people were stealing steel, lifting manhole covers and recycling them. But now, I mean, judging from what's happening in the UK now, steel has fallen to such a low price that it makes you wonder whether people will actually really want to continue replacing manhole covers with or steel covers with composite covers. In actual fact, there are lots of advantages in terms of like ergonomics and how many people it takes to lift a manhole cover and all those sort of things. So there are lots of other advantages as well as just the reduction in the use of steel. This was another thing that we developed. There's a company who were manufacturing these so-called buzz bars, which are these, I expect you know what they are, but they're like big electrical conductors that go down the blocks of flats and office blocks, and you tap off electricity at certain points. And there was a new British standard that required them to replace the organic epoxy resin they were using with something else, because when the resin chars, it creates carbon, which then shorts out the two buzz bars, and so that I can't remember exactly what the specification is, but it's like they have to withstand 1,000 degrees centigrade for 2 hours or something like that without any electrical shorting. So we actually developed an alternative system for this company that allows them to overcome this problem. So this is it's actually a ceramic matrix with special coatings for the metal bars, and we did the research on this and presented them with the solution and a report on it, and they need to now develop it and scale it up to production. So I showed you the toe placement machine before. So we've been using this for making parts for this is a robot that lays down in this case the thermoplastic composite for very high performance applications. So these are some of the parts that we've made for aero composites, which are going to be used by the European Space Agency. So you can see that this part on the right there, the conical part, it's 1.25 meters in diameter, so it's a pretty large structure. And one of the big developments that we've made on this machine is that you can make structures like this in thermoplastic composite without having to subsequently process them in an autoclave to consolidate them. So you can actually make that part directly on the tool, and it doesn't need any further processing treatment. So, I mean, it needs trimming around the edges and that sort of thing, but basically the final part is being made in situ. So that's a major achievement that we've brought in from the work done in IComp. We've also been making large parts for an aerospace company, and also we've also been making parts for another for a UK company, you know, somewhere in the UK. So we've actually this machine, since we got it started about two and a half years ago, it's virtually never stopped. It's been working every day making parts. So it's it's a great success. A tremendous amount of demand for it, and I mean these parts are for aerospace and high performance, but there are lots of other applications for it. Even in the automotive industry and the manufacture of pressure vessels for particularly for automotive and so on. So the machine itself has got a lot of potential, and we, you know, what we're doing is providing opportunities for industry to take this technology forward into these new applications. So this is another some work again that came out of UCD with this surface engineering work, which has been adopted by a major aerospace company for surface activation, cleaning, and also some other technology for the detection of contamination on surfaces that are going to be painted or bonded. So that this all came out of the work done at UCD. Another, I think, quite major achievement is converting recycled PET bottles, PET, polyethylene terephthalate, to high-performance composite materials. And these are materials where the PET matrix is reinforced with PET fibers. So I'll show you what I mean. So PET bottles that we all know and love that we buy for full of water. At the moment, about 2 years ago, there were 17 million tons per annum being manufactured in the world of PET, simply for water bottles. Now, I can go back to the point when I was in ICI and the lads in the lab that I was working in were actually developing that technology. So in a space of, let's say, 25 years, it's gone from the test tube to 17 million tons per annum. Now, you know, when you see all these, when you see water being transported from France to England or somewhere like that, you may wonder whether it to have these water bottles, but anyway, that's where the industry is at the moment. And of course, PET is a very high performance engineering polymer. So there's a company in Ireland, up in Monaghan, called Shabra, who actually take post-consumer plastics, including PET bottles, and they actually sort them and, you know, segregate them and clean them up where necessary, and then they supply them into into end users. So we have a company up in Kells called Wellman International, who are one of the biggest producers of PET fibres in the world from recycled PET. And I think they're making something like 80,000 tons per annum or something, so a very, very large figure. And so, you know, they take in this sort of waste bottles, which come as sort of chopped up flakes of PET. They put them through this fiber spinning machine, and you can see the fibers there going through the machine. And then these are baled to go into applications such as filling duvets, diapers, as they're called, and also filters for various applications. But if anybody ever gets a chance to go to Wellman and see the process, it's absolutely fantastic. You know, you start off with this, they don't like it to call it rubbish, but you're starting off with this sort of recycled material. It's going through this process, and then you finish up with these fantastic, pristine fibers at the end of the day. So what we wanted to do was to try to get these high-performance fibres, or this high-performance polymer, into it's essentially high performance polymer. We wanted to get the fibers into higher performance applications than things like duvets and diapers. So what we did was to develop this concept. We call it SERPET, which is self-reinforced PET fiber. So you can see here you have a high strength core to the fiber, the yellow, and then the blue is an easy melting RPET sheath. And that sheath has got some susceptors in it, which we've developed, which means that it will melt more quickly than the core. So both materials are essentially the same, except the sheath has got some susceptors in it in order to enable it to heat up and melt more rapidly. So you have a high tensile core fiber. And then, so what happens is, you've got your RPET fiber, the grey, and then the sheath, which is the sort of purpley blue colour. So those are the co-extruded fibers. These are the sort of fibers that Wellman can make on a massive scale. You then put those into a sort of a pre-preg form, which I'll show you in a minute. You put it into a press and heat it, and consolidate under pressure, and you get your composite part, which is so you've got your RPET fiber and your matrix there, and so this is what's called a self-reinforcing polymer laminate. So it's PET matrix reinforced with PET fibers, and these are very, very interesting materials. So these are some of the forms that we have, this is like spun fiber here, which is in this case is black, but we have white spun fiber. At the end there, we have a sort of a high tensile fiber, which is a co-extruded fiber, and you can also make a non-woven fabric, which is almost like a felt-like material, which is a very, very great interest to the automotive industry. And these are the so we have woven fabrics and we have a braided fabric there. And so you can weave these things, or you can make them into braiding, or you can make them into non-woven fabrics and so on. So you can make them into all sorts of things. The sheath selectively melts and forms a matrix, which is about 35% by weight of the composite. And the fiber remains as the reinforcing fiber at 65%. And this is a tape form where you can have, so you have PET tape, and on either side of the tape, you have this rapidly melting layer of material. So you can that's a very low-cost process for making a very interesting form of this material. So these are sort of things you can make, self-reinforcing laminates, and this is actually a sandwich panel. So the white bit in the middle is actually PET foam, so it's recycled PET that's been made into a foam, and then you have PET laminates on both sides of it. And these can be used in all these sort of different applications. So one thing I just wanted to mention was the construction industry. These sort of materials have got potential in the construction industry, and if you look at the latest government energy white paper, Ireland's transition to a low carbon energy future 2015 to 2030. Our energy transition will be a positive impact on innovation, economic activity and job creation by encouraging investment in the products, services and technologies needed in our low carbon future. So I think composites have got a very important part to play in that. And one of the things I was wanting to suggest and try to put together, if you like, is a national or international collaborative composites project. And the reason I mentioned construction was because I think it would be quite a challenge, but a very useful way to make use of composites, but also to address some major social issues, which is housing, and both for long-term residency, but also housing for short-term use in, for example, disaster areas where you need floods or earthquakes or whatever, where you need rapid housing to be able to provide housing rapidly. So this could be composite-based housing could be cost-effective, energy-efficient and energy-self-sufficient. It can be flood-resistant. It can be prefabricated. It can be easily transported. rapidly erected and rapidly dismantled. It can have long or short lifetime depending on the application area. And some of the questions, would there be any level of interest, what would the level of interest in this from industry and academia? What would the market size nationally and internationally? Technical viability, economic viability, who would the partners be? Where would we get funding from? Government, industry, Horizon 2020, and what sort of time frame would we need to try to develop this? But I think this is a very, I'd be a very, very positive way for us to use composites. And I know I'm running over time, so there are already these sort of composites business being made in with materials manufactured in Germany and Korea. American company Barcello manufacturing these sort of composite structure, prefabricated buildings. And then in Ireland, we have Kingspan, Tricell. We have people making manhole covers. We have people making these sort of composite structures. We have people making wind turbines. We could actually have flex solar panels for the roofing, solar central heating and hot water, and you know, possibly some of our own materials based on this recycled PET would be. I think we should seriously think about what we can do using composites in the construction industry, particularly for the benefit of Ireland. There's a big construction heritage, shall we say, in Ireland. So, okay. Thanks.
What you call it, what we'll do is we'll leave questions till the end and we'll go over to the end. You're okay, Terry. So I'll call upon our second speaker, which is Dr. Ramesh Raghavendra from WIT. He's in charge of the SEAM, which is the South Eastern Applied Materials Group based in WIT. Ramesh, sorry.
Thanks very much, Paul.
I know where your one is, yeah. Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. And first of all, I would like to thank both Paul and Connor Sheehan of Enterprise Ireland for providing myself and SEAM the opportunity in presenting our center's capability. Yeah. As Paul introduced, our SEAM stands for Southeastern Applied Materials. And my outline is going to be like I will give a brief introduction about SEAM, and I'll be talking about our core capabilities and give some examples about our industry interaction. Our strength is in developing this industry interactions. You will see in my later slides. Yeah, and I'm also going to give just a slide or two on applied research academic activities. And then now we are also heavily involved in Southeast Action Plan for Jobs. And I would like to just point out that what we are doing in that area, and then to finish off with the accomplishments. Yeah. So we are a material science and engineering research center. We work both in industry and academic sphere with the aim of bridging the gap between academia and industry. But having said that, now we are heavily skewed towards industry. So 90% of our time is spent on industrial projects and 10% on academic projects or on pure academic projects. Yeah. And we are based within a very nice part of Ireland from Waterford. I don't call sunny southeast because it has been pretty raining over the last month, except today. Our center was formally launched in 2009, and we started from scratch. Yeah. So whatever you are going to see, it's all happened in the last 7 years. Yeah. We are, since 2013, we are a member of our Technology Gateway Network, which is a nationwide resource for industry, delivering solutions on near-to-market problems for industrial partners. Yeah. To those of you who are not aware of Technology Gateway Network, there are altogether 15 Technology Gateway centers in Ireland. Each one has got their own area of expertise, and we are based in Southeast. In fact, Waterford has got three Technology Gateway. One is ourselves, one in the pharma area, and one in the ICT area. This Technology Gateway Network requires requires establishment of an industrial steering committee, and the steering committee reviews the business activities. And we have a very strong industrial steering committee. As you can see, Shaiwo leads is a chairperson of our committee, and we have members from Stryker, Teva Pharmaceuticals, Boston Scientific, Bosch and Lomb, Honeywell Turbo Technologies, and Nipro. Committee meets every quarterly and reviews just the business end of it. Yeah, we won't be discussing any technical side. It's only just purely on the business side activities. Yeah, and from SEAM and WIT, myself and two members from WIT sits in the committee, and there is always an observer from Enterprise Ireland. Yeah. Okay, so now what we do is we provide unique world-class professional services, yeah, in terms of delivering innovative materials engineering solutions, and we create value-added competitiveness using the latest technologies to deliver real solutions for real problems. In terms of the reason why I call unique is that, you know, I always, when I took over, I always try to bring in the technology which is unique, which is not available in Ireland, and then try to use the technologies, develop expertise, and then provide the services to industries in those kind of latest technologies. Yeah, we had the first CT scanner in 2009, and at that time, I think we were the first, I think, okay, when Trinity had a smaller scans, a CT scanner, then we bought that advanced one, and that in 2009, and we used a CT scan to provide non-destructive 3D analysis of materials and components. We also do a lot of product design optimization through overlaying of scanned CT data over original CAD data. And we also provide 3D metrology solutions. Now, in the last 7 years, we can safely say we are the center of excellence for CT in Ireland. Yeah. We have two CT scanners, you will see later on. And we have developed so much of expertise. We are trying to use the CT for various wide-ranging applications for industries. Yeah. And the other technology what we use heavily for industry is both FEA, finite element modeling, and also computational fluid dynamics. Yeah, what is unique about that is we have a commercial ANSYS CFX license. Yeah, and then of course we do a lot of failure analysis of product components. This I call it as a bread and butter issues for industries. The industries can walk in, and then we in fact on average we get at least two companies a day. Yeah. Working with their issues, and then we discuss and then try to provide solutions for them, yeah. And then provider of a bespoke solutions for our customer specific issues. And then since the last 1.5 years, we are working on 3D metal additive manufacturing. Okay, as I was telling you, we have two walk-in CT systems at SEAM, probably the only person in an academic institute to have two walk-in CT systems in a research institute. In research environments. One is a 180 kV systems, which we predominantly use for investigating polymeric materials and also low density metallic materials. And then we have a 300 kV dual system, 300 kV system, where we analyze a lot of high density metallic materials. Yeah, this can take up to 2 foot long metallic polymeric materials, and this can also analyze a high density metallic materials like superalloys, yeah, like F1 turbocharged rotors, something like that, yeah. But when we bought this one in 2013, this was the advanced CT at that stage. But now, in the last 2 years, GE Phoenix have introduced a 450 kV system, which we are now trying to see whether we can get that on board here. Because with the two CT systems what we have, we can assist almost 75% of the industries in Ireland, yeah. If we can get this 450 kV system, then we can assist almost 100% of the industries in Ireland, and we are working towards that. Okay, to those of you who are not much familiar with the CT, right? I mean, it is a non-destructive, it can visualize objects in 3D, and once you get the CT data, then you can characterize for porosity, voids or defects, and then for warping, skewing, delamination, coordinate measurements, and nominal comparisons. You can do everything once you get your CT data, yeah. We have all the up-to-date software, and we have the expertise in those applications, yeah. This is just to have shown examples of the porosities and other things, yeah. So this is the video to just showing the nominal comparison, which we use for wide-ranging industries. The top one shows the is a scanned CT data, and the bottom one is a CAD file. So once you do the CT, we can overlay the CT data with the original CAD file, and you can see that directly the variance. You can visually see the variations, yeah. All the green areas are bang in the middle of the spec, and the rim where you can see the red color are above spec, and the blue regions are below spec, yeah. So industries really love this, yeah, because they can visually see the variances, and also we can quantify as well how much they are away from the specs, yeah. Again, no, the CT applications we have used for wide-ranging applications. Even the manufacturers have not even thought of that these machines can be used for that. Such is the level of expertise that exists in SEAM. Yeah, just to give you, just to provide you some examples for pharmaceutical tablets, and I'll show you a video of that one. And then you can see for a defect analysis for porosities or inclusion in castings. And we also can do. We have done recently a project for Glanbia. For Sagask, yeah. Analysis of conglomerations of particles in a milk powder, and then the quality of wells, coordinate measurements, and also a visualization of volunteering in catheters. Yeah, so pharma, medical, industrial technology, food sectors, and so forth. Yeah. Okay, before I go that now, I just want to show you just one small slide about, for example, if you see the, just to show you the powerful nature of the technology, who, for those of you who are not familiar with this, you can see it here. This is just after doing the CT scan, we create videos like this for the company where they can visually see the depth of information, yeah. This was unthinkable until a few years ago, yeah. You can see all the powder packing densities, and we can quantify all the packing densities, and if there is any cracks or voids or whatever it is, right? We can show that here. So this is for a pharmaceutical application. And okay, the next one I'll show you will be a kind of a stepper motor, yeah. Okay, you can see it here, sorry. Oh, sorry, it did work before. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, sorry about that, anyway, it seems like it did work before when I checked. Anyway, let us move on to that one. Okay, let us talk about that. Okay, in terms of FEA, of course, you're all engineers. I mean, you should be knowing about this FEA thing. But what we are applying the CT, okay, as you know, finite element analysis is a powerful computer-based tool widely used for understanding the mechanics of a physical system. We have applied this FEA both for a new product design to verify whether the proposed design meets the required spec prior to manufacturing, or we have also applied to existing product refinement, yeah. Qualifying existing product for a new service condition, yeah. And again, we have used FEA for wide-ranging applications from aerospace to electronics to biomedical industries, yeah. In fact, we have done three or four innovation partnerships using FEA. Just to give you, and since we have a CT, right, it's an ideal combination of FEA and a CT. It's a lethal combination of providing the services to industry. Yeah. Just to give you an example of a project was undertaken to study the vial seal integrity. Yeah. In fact, a lot of pharmaceutical and also other industries have a issue of these vial seals. We have addressed the issue using both CT and FEA modeling of the stopper vials, and which given improved understanding of the factors that influence in the sealing of vial integrity. Yeah. And then, okay, in terms of additive manufacturing refers to a process by which digital 3D design data is used to build up in layers by depositing the material. Of course, you're all familiar with this thing, but the term 3D printing is increasingly used as a synonym for additive manufacturing. In our case, in SEAM, we use a direct metal laser sintering. We have a EOS M280 machine, and this uses laser to fuse small particles of metal powders into a mass that has desired three-dimensional shape. And then the laser selectively fuses metal powders by scanning cross-sections generated from a 3D CAD or XMT scan data on the surface of a powder bed. And after each cross-section is scanned, the powder bed is slowly lowered by one layer thickness, and a new layer of material is applied on top, and the process is repeated until the part is completed. In fact, now this is a kind of a bottom-up process where you have the powder blade here, the powder reservoir here, and then you have your build plate here. So the rotor blade sweeps one layer of powder, and then the laser selectively melts the region of interest, and then the rotor blade goes back and brings another layer of powder, and it builds up like that, yeah. So now SEAM, we were earlier, before we had this 2 years ago, we were already doing design work for some company in terms of additive manufacturing. And we were also doing a lot of validation work for a company. But now since we have the 3D metal printer, we can design, optimize, we can build, and we can validate, yeah. So we can now offer full design to prototyping service for industry, yeah. So again, no, this is one of the things. Now we bring in the technology, we try to expertise it, familiarize it, and then provide that knowledge transfer to the industry. That's our mission. So the advantage of AM is that now designing complex components without adding cost, surpass limitations of conventional technology, because here the geometry, the complexness doesn't come into picture at all. Yeah, you can build any complex geometry. That is the advantage of AM. Yeah, it skips investment in manufacturing tools, change designs without hassle, and short time to market. And the other key advantage of AM is disrupting the supply chain. If there are 6 or 7 process steps, you can do it in 1 or 2 process steps. Yeah, that is the biggest advantage. Yeah. So in terms of other capabilities, we have a white light interferometry where we do both surface topography as well as surface roughness analysis. We have used extensively to evaluate the quality of finish on laser cut strengths for a lot of medical device industries and also for turbine blades. And we have also measured the coating thicknesses. We are still doing, we are doing a lot of coating thickness measurements using this technology. And of course, we have the normal scanning control microscope with the elemental detector attachment. So we do a lot of contamination investigations. And then we have a whole range of other series of equipment, like from mechanical testing machines and hardness testers and OES, and then all the thermal analysis equipment which are required for polymeric industries. Yeah. Again, these are all the equipment which we bought in the last 7 years. We are slowly building our center. Yeah. And again, one of our key strengths is that we do develop custom test methods. A lot of companies comes with a non-standard samples and non-standard test requirements. Yeah, so we do build the required jigs for those kind of investigations. For example, on the left-hand side is a pressure test systems which we built for a precision engineering company, and then the last one, for example, is a tensile test jig which we built to simulate how a contact lenses gets released from the mold. Yeah, so we built the jig and we put it under the CT. We applied the pressure, so the stress, and then we simulated how the contact lens gets released from the mold. Yeah. So we assist industries across wide-ranging divisions within an industry, whether it is for a product design or a new product development, process control, failure analysis, quality assurance, and reverse engineering. But most of our work falls under failure analysis and reverse engineering, and then the third one will be product design and the new product development. Yeah. So just to give you a flavor of a project, right, because our industrial projects, right, we work across wide-ranging industrial sectors, right, and these examples it reflects the versatility of the expertise that exists in our center. Of course, I can't go into the details because these are all industrial projects. Anyway, I think you will know from the titles which company this could be. Yeah. For example, design verification of asthmatic inhalers, examining the leak paths in hubs of balloon catheters, understanding the root cause for discoloration in pharmaceutical tablets, understanding the mechanism of failure that may occur during crimping of cable ends, examining the strength, roughness, and metrology verification, sourcing and characterizing new materials for sports mat applications, improving the cycle life of process control valves for use in solvent streams, and understanding the drill head fracture mechanisms and development of a design optimized drill head for down the hole drilling applications. The last two are innovation partnerships, and we have licenses in both these technologies. Yeah. So innovation partnership, again, since 2009, we have completed 6 innovation partnerships, and one for Stryker, one for Zenzyme, one for Mincon, which is an Irish company where they make their drill heads, yeah, based in Shannon. And we have completed 2 for Bosch and Lomb and 1 for Cotton Control. Yeah. And the Cotton Control project, which was finished last year in March, was so successful. Within 3 months, they want to do another innovation partnership. So we had a back-to-back innovation partnership, and that is a 400K again. So very big innovation partnership. And since the last 1.5 years, we are also working with a multi-party innovation partnership project involving a multinational company, which is, of course, you might have seen this the publication of this, Boston, Shivo, and Leo company are involved in this to work in the area of 3D metal additive manufacturing. Yeah. So the types of service SEAM offers to industry, 70% of work. We are one of the heavily direct funded centers, I can say that in the country, right? In fact, 70% of our funding comes directly from industry. Yeah. So we do a lot direct funded short term, medium projects, right? 70% of our time is spent on 3-day to 5-day projects. Yeah, what I call bread and butter issue of the company. Yeah. And then we do research and development. So that comes under that, for that innovation voucher, and innovation partnerships falls under that category. And then we source funding opportunity for industries, and then innovation and technology transfer. Yeah. So in fact, on action plan of jobs, we do a lot of technology transfer. We organize a lot of workshops for industries. Yeah, on the technologies what we have in house. So, starting from zero, starting from 2009, we now assist over 120 companies in Ireland, yeah. Out of which nearly 70% of them are multinationals and 30% of them are SMEs, yeah. So, in terms of applied research activities, right, because, I mean, since we only started from 2009, since for the first four years, we laid a strong foundation, yeah. But now in the last 2 to 3 years, we are trying to develop our own platform technologies. Being an applied research center, we need to have our own patents and other things. So we got two comp funds 2 years ago, and so one is we are working on developing an arthroscopically accessible cartilage defect measuring device. So in fact, the prototype has been developed. At present, we are doing cadaver trials, yeah. And the second one is developing a prolonged release of injectable delivery system for a certain medical condition. This is jointly with a pharmaceutical group within WIT, PMBRC, and we have developed a biodegradable polymer, and the pharmacy group, of course, their contribution is from the pharma side, from the drug side. And again, the prototype has been done, and at present, the animal trials are ongoing, yeah. And the third one is we got a FP7 SME program. We just only finished in December of last year, which is the development of a novel sensor system for real-time in-situ monitoring of tool wear in precision engineering applications. I coordinated that program, and so going forward, we are now looking for Horizon 2020, yeah. So we also now started supervising PhDs. So 2 years ago, now I have two PhDs, and then, of course, we undertake undergraduate mechanical engineering projects, yeah. So we take at least two projects a year. And then we also provide placement training for the third year mechanical engineering students from WIT. So I just want to just tell you about the Southeast Action Plan for Jobs. Recently, I think last year, June, Richard Bruton, the minister or minister for jobs and enterprise, or at present, should say caretaker jobs for an enterprise minister, released this document, Southeast Action Plan for Jobs. We figure heavily on the 3D metal printing side, yeah. So we have a lot of action items in that, and we have delivered whatever we said we will deliver under that action plan for jobs. For example, efforts to in progress to enhance a 3D metal printing capability and validation capability. We have the 3D printer and we have the post-processing equipment, but we need more of these if you need to assist for a lot more industries, yeah. So the efforts are in progress to enhance our facility, and we already organized two industry-focused workshops, one in Q3 and one in Q4 of 2015 for select group of industries. We take around 14 or 15 companies, and we provide them the workshop, yeah, in this area to disseminate the advances in additive manufacturing, to make them aware or to prepare them for additive manufacturing technology, yeah. And a third workshop is planned on May 18th, and this time we are focusing on the electronic industry sector. We are also assisting multiple companies in the area of 3D additive manufacturing, and then enhancing the applied research capabilities specifically related to the applications in AM. Some of the medical device companies are asking to bring the students because they are finding skill shortage in this area, right? So we are now going forward, most of our PhDs will be in the area of additive manufacturing, yeah. So I'd like to finish off with accomplishments. We have established collaborations with over 120 companies, and we have executed over 900 direct funded industrial projects since 2009. Yeah, this is in terms of the per capita. I think we should safely say that we are one of the highest direct funded projects in the country. Yeah, and in terms of client companies, nearly 30% of our companies are in medical devices, and then 30% are in precision engineering companies, and the rest forms the other industrial sector. This is one which I've already shown you, that we have expanded our client base. And finally, over the last 2 years, we were shortlisted for Irish Lab Awards and the Waterford Business Award in 2015. But last year, April, we won the Knowledge Transfer Ireland Award under Industrial Consultancy Impact category. Yeah. So with this, I would like to finish. And thank you very much for your attention. Yeah.
Again, I'll just remind you, we'll keep questions to the end. I call upon our last speaker, David Tormey from PEM, which is Precision Engineering Materials and Manufacturing Research Centre based in IT Sligo.
Thanks, Paul. Okay, good evening. My name is David Tormey. I'm a senior lecturer in mechanical engineering and director of the Centre for Precision Engineering Materials and Manufacturing Research at IT Sligo. I'd just like to thank Engineers Ireland and Enterprise Ireland for giving me the opportunity here to speak. So my presentation basically will give you a bit of a brief overview of our centre capabilities, and I'll present a number of different industrial case studies we've been involved in over the last couple of years. We, like SEAM, are a technology gateway centre. We are establishing an institute itself nearly 3 years, but more recently we received funding from Enterprise Ireland to establish ourselves as a gateway. We're not as long in the game as Ramesh. We're 3 months, so a bit of catch up there would seem. But we're delighted with the funding from Enterprise Ireland, and it gives us a nice base to engage and work with industry on applied research projects. So in terms of how we support and engage industry, basically, in summary, we help companies design and manufacture small components that require higher degrees of precision engineering and accuracy. And we do this through a number of different technology categories, which we've identified here through a lot of industry consultation that has informed the overall PEM Gateway strategic plan over the next couple of years. So there's quite a lot of rationale and logic behind these different four categories. And they relate to precision engineering and design, manufacturing process model and simulation, advanced process monitoring and control, and advanced material synthesis characterization technologies. So they're quite discrete in their own right, yet provide a lot of complement and convergence in terms of being able to work and engage industry on projects relating to precision engineering, relating either design or manufacturing process requirements that might be needed. In terms of the overall structure, there's five kind of core PIs within the center itself. And each of these PIs is leading out a different technology offering category. And with each of these categories, there's also a structure in terms of postdocs, PhD students, and master's students. So I'll talk a bit about the precision engineering design one, which I'm working with Dr. Richard Sherlock on. In terms of some of the areas of interest that we work with and engage industry with, they range from non-conventional machining, and I'll be presenting a case study in this area in quite shortly. Laser machining, polymer welding, simulating tool wear, different cutting force characterization on different cutting applications, metrology validation, product design for manufacturing, and additive manufacturing. We have some 3D printing capability in the form of FDM and SLA. We haven't got the lovely EOS machine that Ramesh has. So we're quite jealous there, but we're also involved in getting engaged in that particular research niche. Just to give you a kind of a flavour of the profile of the PIs within the PEM group itself. So obviously we are full-time academics, so peer-reviewed applications are important, but more I suppose applicable here in terms of the type of research we do. And it has always been applied research, and all the PIs within the PEM group have been engaged directly with industry throughout their time in IT Sligo and also previously in industry and different other research centres that have worked and collaborated with industry itself. So over the last kind of 5-6 year period, collectively we would have been involved in a number of projects with industry which have been funding will secure directly either from industry or from different research programs such as Innovation Partnership or Interreg or FP7, etc. Cumulatively, they would be about over 100 industrial projects that we have again been involved in. They'd be ranging from innovation voucher scale right up to FP7. And the contribution from industry into those projects would be approximately about 1 million. Also, we're very keen and interested in terms of commercialization of research. A few of us have been involved in different patent applications. And again, then going back to our academic outputs, we have a number of master's and PhD students, so it's important that we can also produce good, high-skilled quality graduates who then can go and work in industry. Haven't got pictures here, I'm afraid, but we do have a range of equipment, not as extensive as SEAM, but we have a lot of material characterization equipment from XRD to TEM to SEM. We have a number of 3D printing machines from FDM and SLA. 3D scanning technology as well. We have a good materials lab that has capability in terms of tensile testing, impact testing, a wide range of different modeling simulation software for FEM and CFD analysis. We're also currently in the process of procuring a lot of new capital. We've got approval internally from the Institute to €1 million to invest in equipment that will have relevance in terms of the research we do, but also in some of the teaching programs we do in IT Sligo as well. And there, that investment is ranging from metrology validation, coordinate measurement machines, multi CNC, wire EDM. So that we're hoping to have that capital in place hopefully towards the end of the year. And that will again provide a lot of support to the activities we do within the gateway itself. Okay, so I'm going to talk about the first case study I'm going to present here. Was an FP7 project that I coordinated and managed a couple of years ago. And this was funded under a program called the Research for Benefit SMEs. And it related to a non-conventional machining process called ECM, electrochemical machining, and I'll explain a bit about that later on. But the applications are quite wide and varied in terms of the sector use, from automotive to aerospace to medical device. And this total funding was €1.6 million over a two-year period, €1.2 million directly from the European Commission, and the balance in terms of funding from the SMEs. So it's a transnational collaboration, as these European projects are. There was a number of partners, SMEs and universities from over four countries, Ireland, UK, Germany and Belgium. IT Sligo were the coordinated partner on it, and we worked with two other Irish SMEs, Vox Power, who were a power supply company based here in Dublin, and an R&D company based up in Letterkenny called CDAMC. So in terms of the relationship here between the partners for the project, so the Research for Benefit SME program essentially funds SMEs to contract research in. So they get the funding and they work with different universities or RTD providers who do the research. And at the end of the project, the IP is all assigned back to the SMEs. So the research provider gets 100% funding. And the SMEs get a 75% rate, and they get the IP on top of that as well. So the project components really were kind of threefold. There was a power supply unit requirement, and I'll talk about that in a minute. We needed some numerical modeling to do and complete to inform different power supply parameters we needed to understand. And then ultimately those work packages also were used to inform the overall design of an ECM demonstrator, a prototype, for this new, well, not new, but it's an advancement on existing ECM capability called micro-ECM. Just to give you a bit of taxonomy on conventional machining processes, essentially they can be divided into three different strands: mechanical processes, electrothermal processes, and chemical and electrochemical processes as well. So our focus was very much on the latter one there, the electrochemical processes. So ECM is essentially, it's very similar to an electroplating process, and it works on the principles of Faraday's law. Basically, you have a tool, which is your cathode, and your workpiece being your anode. And the difference between this process and, say, electroplating is basically the DC power supply, the current going to it, the polarity of that current is reversed, and metal ions start plating up from the workpiece onto cathode. But before they can actually plate the cathode, they're flushed away with an electrolyte solution, typically sodium nitrate or sodium chloride. And so the advancement for our project here, typically commercial ECM machines pulse within a millisecond range. So we're looking at a micro ECM process, which basically is design, development, integration of a power supply capable of nanosecond pulsing at high frequencies. And that's important because the shorter the pulse and the higher the frequency of the pulse, the more accurate the machining process becomes and can produce better surface finish and better degree of accuracy on the part of your machining as well. So What are the advantages of BCM? So non-conventional machining processes typically are defined by a process where the tool, machining tool, does not come in contact with the workpiece. So the advantage there being basically there is no thermal or mechanical stresses induced during the machining process. So the part itself that's been machined isn't necessarily subjected to these stresses that can result in deterioration of fatigue life. There's also obviously there's no contact with the tool piece and the part being machined. There's no tool wear, and irrespective of the material in terms of hardness properties, it's irrelevant because it can machine very difficult and hard materials such as titanium as easily as it can, you know, machine as something of a softer composition. And ECM systems, of course, these days are all CNC controlled as well. So going back to, I guess, our role in this project, besides coordinating it, we had responsibility also to work with the SME partner, Vox Power in Dublin, to design and develop the power supply for this demonstrator machine. So looking at your typical kind of PSU characteristics, they're quite different to what was expected, you know, in terms of a novel PSU for micro for nanosecond pulsing. So your pulsing stage feed is fed through a filter to provide the DC voltage load of the actual PSU unit itself. So in very short pulses, you can't use a filter. Okay, so that's a constraint. Your typical PSU frequency operates between 200 kilohertz and 1 megahertz. We were looking at high frequency up to 45, 50 megahertz. So there's quite a leap there from that. In terms of the MOSFETs that are used for the switching technology, these are usually traditionally silicon-based. They wouldn't cut it for the application that we needed to do. So we needed a PSU. That was capable of pulse voltage without filtering, switching frequencies up to 50 megahertz, and looking then at alternative switch technologies where required. And one of the novelties in this was we're able to look at alternative semiconductor materials such as gallium nitride or gallium arsenic. And these relate to the FETs, these field effect transistors that you know essentially cause the switching to occur. And these would be to replace the kind of the silicon MOSFETs that are traditionally used. So we're able to look at applying these GaNFETs, these gallium nitride FETs, and integrate them onto a board. And that allowed us to really increase the switching frequency to a very high level, which we wouldn't have been able to do with your typical silicon-based MOSFET. So the challenges here were to generate 50 megahertz pulse width modulated control signal. The power switches had to be extremely fast, less than 3 nanoseconds, and have a very, very, very low capacitance. Also, we had to be able to measure and sense different resistivity changes at the machine gap. And that was difficult to do at very high frequencies. It's certainly in the order of 50 megahertz, becomes quite a technical challenge. And one of the biggest challenges we encountered here was inductance. So you're operating at a very high frequency. You get a lot of parasitic inductance within the components and the cables of the actual PSU itself. So that had a bearing in terms of where the PSU could be located. So we had to locate it very, very close to the tool itself. And we had to minimize and reduce any type of cabling and wires because of this inductance issue that operates at high frequencies. So the design challenge was laid out, and we were able to develop a modulated pulse capability of up to 45 megahertz. Your typical PSU operates within the range of 5 volts to 25 volts, with a corresponding amperage of somewhere between 10 to 30 in typical commercial ECM machines. We were able to deliver that pulse amplitude at 20 amps. We need to be able to have process feedback. So I should have probably explained earlier, what's crucial is the machine gap. between the machine tool and the part being machined. There's a small gap that needs to be controlled at a constant distance. Sometimes it could be in the order of microns. And we need to be able to measure the change in resistance occurring at the inter-electrode gap to give feedback to ensure that the gap is maintained constant. And that was also quite a challenge to overcome. The demonstrator itself, the ECM demonstrator that was designed and built, was working off a control system called Delta Tau. We had to integrate our PSU into that control system, and that was done using a Texas Instrument module that we were able to code and integrate our own PSU into. And we were able to, in terms of location of where the PSU module would be inserted on the demonstrator, we were able to minimize quite significantly any parasitic inductance. Even at that, we still had other inductance issues to kind of resolve. The demonstrator is here in the picture on the right. This was the finished experimental demonstrator we produced, and this is based over in a factory in Germany. And we done a lot of machine trials with this demonstrator. I haven't time to go into quite them all today, obviously, and some of them are quite sensitive in terms of results. But what I have here basically is two materials we tested. One was nickel chrome, and one was copper. So with the nickel chrome that you see there, you don't see much machining being done there. So that was pulsing around 500 nanoseconds for about 6 minutes, and we only had a penetration of maybe 6 microns in there. And what we found out from the numerical modeling that was completed in Belgium, that there's a passivation layer occurs on the surface of the material. And the useful portion of the current, called the Faradaic portion of the current, is essentially charged in that capacitance layer and not done any useful machine work. So the passivation is an issue depending on the material that you're machining. And that also holds very true for titanium as well. So to overcome that dilemma, you could use a higher voltage initially, and work within a millisecond pulse range to burst through the passivation and then step it back down to nanosecond pulse. So depending on the material and depending on the electrolyte you're using as well, all these different parameters have impact or implication on the overall machine and process itself. But something like copper, where oxidation and passivation doesn't occur, on this particular process here, you get a nice kind of depth profile here. So this was machining for about, I think, 5 or 6 minutes at a 500 nanosecond pulse range. There's quite a difference in terms of the profile that you get with a copper at a nanosecond range compared to materials such as nickel chrome. So the overall advances made by this project, we were able to design and develop a switch-mode power supply that was capable of a very high frequency, up to 45 megahertz, with a nanosecond pulse limitation of about 14 nanoseconds. Now, you know, you wouldn't be typically using pulses for that duration to be too short, but that capability was there in terms of ranging from 100 nanoseconds to, you know, up to 500. Depending again on the material, the machine, and the electrolyte you're using. We were able to resolve our parasitic inductance problems as that occur as a result of the frequency generation. And even with the location of where the power supply module went, very close to the actual machine tool, there was still quite a lot of inductance that was happening. And we came up with a kind of novel idea. Well, we think it was novel anyway. The partner of Vox Power actually came up with this idea of, if you see over in the far picture there, you see a kind of cage. So there's an array of gold-plated pins that clamp onto the actual part you're machining. And the cathode, the machine tool itself, is located in the center of that. So basically, those pins act as a Faraday cage, and that contains all the inductance to a typical tool. So we're able to quite reduce our inductance issues down to about 50 nanohenries, located just right on the tool tip itself. So that was quite a good achievement from this project. Because anything to do with high frequency will always have a problem associated with the inductance around that. Also the other kind of advancement here, it was the integration of the power supply within the overall control strategy that was designed and developed for this machine. And we were able to demonstrate the proof of principle in relation to machine and material at a very short pulse duration, nanosecond range, at high frequencies. So the second case study I have here, and this is a more recent project. Again, this is funded from the FP-SEM program, Research for the Benefit of SMEs again, and my colleague, Dr. Mary McAfee, coordinated this particular project. And this is titled Biopolytech. So it's a 1 million euro funded project for 2 years, ran from December 2013 to end of November last year. And we had 8 partners from 4 different countries, Finland, Germany, France, UK. So this particular project related to the extrusion of a bioresorbable material called PLA, polylactic acid. And PLA is used, quite mainstream. A lot of PLA is, your coffee cups, the lids are generally made up from PLA. And this is a naturally degradable material. It's quite common, as I said, but the medical grade version of PLA is hugely expensive. And one of the partners in this consortium, Skaptex, based in Finland, they produce scaffold material that are used for implants for arthritic joints. So these are scaffolds that go onto your knuckle joints where you experience an arthritic pain. Over time, obviously, they degrade. So degradation rate is hugely important. But the problem associated with the process and extrusion of medical-grade PLA is it's done by trial and error, traditionally. And so it leads to high levels of scrap and low production yields. So this project really focused on the developing novel instrumentation and control technology to rapidly optimize process setup and reduce scrap rates. So your bioresorbable polymer, your PLA, goes into your hopper, and you always have batch variation relating to the actual pellet itself. Sometimes the moisture content could be out, and there's different additives also included within that polymer itself. So it goes into your screw, and depending on your production run, you might get variation, in that process. Which basically results in trial and error and your increased scrap rate. So the novelty of this project was basically done in situ monitoring of the extrusion. Okay, the polymer coming out of the extruder, and we're able to use some soft sensing technology to do different inferential spectrometry methods to determine the agglomeration of the polymer melt. Looking at the additive particle size, particle shape, and dispersion. And all these were indicators of how the process was performing, whether it's in spec or out of spec. So based on that inline monitoring, situ monitoring, we could feed back to the control in terms of adapting different process parameters, be it temperature, pressure, or screw rate, to ensure that the process remains in spec. So our partner in Germany, FOSS, they have a lot of expertise in different probe technology. So we're using the fiber octave probe technology with IR capability, what was developed by FOSS and then integrated onto injection or extruder up in Queens. And we're able to analyze the actual polymer melt itself in situ and look at predicting, you know, the degradation rate and look at that additive dispersion in situ and how that corresponds to out-of-spec process parameters. So the benefits here to be realized, reduction of development times and costs for new bioresorbable medical implants, and this is of particular interest, of course, to Skaptics, the SME partner from Finland, who were part of this consortium, looking at improving batch-to-batch consistency, better understanding and be able to predict degradation rates of medical device implants as they are, you know, in use. The most significant benefit, obviously, is the reduction in scrap levels and reduction in time cost to, in terms of trial and error, in terms of producing polymer compounds as well. So we had one of the partners in this was a producer of different polymer compounds. So it allowed, again, I suppose, them to understand better how their compounds are processed in situ, which obviously then can feed back in terms of how they compound the material in the first instance. So reduction in energy costs also demanded by extensive trial periods. So trial periods can be greatly reduced because you're able to kind of do the trial analysis in situ. And overall improved yield and throughput rates to increase manufacturing process efficiency. So I've just done two more kind of case studies, very quick ones. And these relate to innovation voucher projects we've done, which just two companies I've listed here. The first company is a company based up in Cavan, and they design and manufacture power tools that use pneumatic compressed air. And this particular problem here related to the motor housing, okay? And your design constraints here basically is they want to maximize torque, but you're constrained by the chamber design and the shaft and the pressure coming in, okay? So basically you have here a chamber, a shaft, and a number of discs located on that shaft. And you pressure coming in, and it's fed through the shaft up through vanes within these discs, okay? And the discs then, the air comes up the vanes and is ejected out of a number of different nozzles that are tangential to the circumference of the disc. So they've been ejected 90 degrees out, which gives the thrust of the disc, and that then is ejected back out the motor housing there at the bottom. So the design dilemma here was how do you maximize the torque efficiency for this device without having to have ability to, you know, alter drastically the overall design of the housing of the motor. So we were looking at basically doing some theoretical modeling and CFD analysis. So we were able to the disc kind of configuration and adapt the design based on CFD analysis. And then we were able to physically test that because they have a physical test rig to do this as well. And we found basically that we were able to design these discs and with different configurations and 3D print them and then insert them and do the physical experimentation and verify, I guess, the results we get from the CFD analysis. And so the outcomes for this particular project, we were able to demonstrate, you know, through CFD analysis and physical experimentation, that certain disc configurations were able to increase the torque level output. And so the other case study, last case study I have here, is a company based up in Leitrim called Miranda, and they process wood veneer. And one of the particular processes to have is the application of a primer onto an ABS sheet. And this process is manually controlled. So it was leading to a lot of variation in terms of quality assurance. So they were asking us in terms of advising, you know how could we maybe better control and monitor, you know, how this primer is applied. Now you could, you know, invest in a very expensive vision system to do this, but they wouldn't have the budget to do that. So we were looking at different other alternative options. And the first thing to do, I guess, was to look at the variation in the coating. So we're able to do some kind of sim analysis on that and do a feasibility study in terms of different testing techniques that could be applied at a low cost. One of the I guess the options that are now is now being considered is kind of batch testing using kind of a ultrasonic device that's able to kind of give an indication very quickly whether the batch is in variance or not. So for them, you know, the project itself was able to kind of rule out, you know, certain things that would have costed a lot. So from that point of view, you know, the focus was really about trying to identify technology that you know could be used, but also was in, you know, the appropriate budget range. So that's all I have. Just want to thank you for your time and look forward to your questions.
Okay. Can I just ask the speakers to go up to the table up here just for probably get sorted. So just hang on. Is that if you can wait until we get a microphone to you if you're going to ask a question, it's just so that a few people online as well, so it's handy for them to be able to hear the question rather than us actually having to actually repeat it. So is there any questions from the audience? And immediately? I'll just ask... I'll just ask the speakers, you're all based in academic institutions. Is there anything that kind of Ireland is not good at in terms of making use of academic institutions for kind of either kind of driving kind of research or integrating with industry? Because that's what I always feel is that, like as an academic myself working in Tala, we were kind of very much tied to the wheel. And so therefore you get very little chance to actually go out to industry unless you like make an extra special effort. So I don't know if anybody wants to answer that question. Ramesh?
Yeah. Paul, let you know. Now this technology gateway program also, I mean, could be applicable to technology centers as well, right? Now all these centers are excellent in fact, now the enterprise island with the broad in this kind of program, right? It's an excellent program for industry, sir. So
yeah.
Hello?
Yeah. For example, this technology gateway program from Enterprise Ireland, it gives the kind of an opportunity for industries. Yeah, and in fact, as I was mentioning in my presentation, there are now 15 centers here, which covers almost all areas which are required for industries, right? And now there is so much of awareness. We have almost, I think, at least three times in a year, we have made various events for exposure of the existence of the centers, yeah. So to answer your question, Paul, yeah, so there are centers that now there are so many, technology gateway centers, technology centers, and SFI research centers. A lot of centers are there for industries to get benefit, both in terms of academic expertise as well as the applied research expertise from industries, yeah, from the academic institutes to industries.
Just to echo Ramesh's comments, the gateway program, the Enterprise Ireland Fund, has been critical, I guess, for building awareness of the level of intellectual capital invested in universities and ITs. A lot of time, I guess, companies might not necessarily know what goes on in university or college. The primary, you know, say perspective or view is that we teach, you know, that we're not necessarily engaged appropriately, which is not necessarily true. Certainly the gateway and the technology centers as well in universities, I think, are slowly trying to kind of break down that barrier and perception. Mm-hmm. And I think there's still a long way to go.
Yeah.
But it's the last couple of years, the investment been made, you know, in through different programs such as gateways and technology centers and SFI centers has starting to bear fruit. And I think it's a good use of taxpayers' money, I would say that.
just David, just Just, I want to ask you one question related to particularly to IT Sligo. I know you're involved as kind of on a kind of precision machining effort up there in Sligo to drive kind of on the education side, because I know there's been a kind of a national shortage of kind of machinists and that sort of thing. So would you like to make a comment just on that?
Yeah, I guess the kind of tool making and tool design industry was born in the northwest of Sligo, or northwest of Ireland, around the Sligo region, over 40 years ago. And we have a lot of, you know, precision engineering companies based in the northwest and users of precision engineering services, multinationals who use expertise of you know, tool design companies and tool makers. Our programs have been informed very much from our history in the Northwest. So we were the National Center for Excellence in Precision Engineering. And we teach, you know, from level 6 apprenticeship in tool making. Our mechanical engineering programs, level 7, level 8, have been very influenced and informed by our heritage and history. And more recently, we've progressing, you know, to research level, you know, level 9s and 10s in terms of our masters and PhDs, and our PI staff are very much working in the cutting edge of advanced machine and technology in manufacturing. So part of that 1 million investment I mentioned there is kind of the confirmation, you know, from our institute that you know, we are very much you know, in this space as a national centre. That's been recognised.
Yeah, that's great to hear. Any questions from the floor there at the back? I'll just ask Terry just one question. You mentioned ag machinery there. Could you make just a further comment on that?
that's not working. It is?
Yeah. I mean, with ground transportation,
it's not
going into, you know, buses, trains, and even, you know, quite a lot of heavy plant like diggers and so on. And, you know, we haven't really been able to, or we haven't involved ourselves yet in the agricultural industry.
Okay.
My question kind of follows on from that, and that is in respect of composites in engineering use, particularly say in large scale components and so on, what's the situation in respect of the technology for fault detection? And because say in the lectures, in the presentations, there was kind of a lot of laboratory based type equipment for analyzing structure and so on. But in terms of once these things go out in use, you know, for example, like wind turbine blades or something like that, what sort of technology is out there for kind of in-service monitoring and, you know, and detection of failure mechanisms?
Yeah, I mean, this is a major challenge to I think everyone who's using composites, even right down from you know, from the aerospace industry, who ideally would like to be able to, you know, what they call do health monitoring on composite structures over a long period of time. So there are a lot of opportunities for example, building in sensors and ways of detecting any changes that may occur in the structure. So there's a lot of advances that have been made like that. But then when you come to the other things, like say wind turbine blades, for example, it's quite difficult to have people you know, climbing up wind turbine blades to look at them to see whether there have been any changes and so on. And in actual fact, via a commercialisation project, which has been obviously funded by Enterprise Ireland, people down in Limerick have actually developed a way to monitor wind turbine blades from a static position on the ground, so you can actually look at the way the blades are moving, and you can actually detect any changes that may be resulting from, let's say, erosion or any other damage to the blades, and then that information can be fed to the to the people who own the field, who can then decide, if you can quantify that change, you can then decide whether you can leave it or whether you need to repair it urgently and so on. So this is an ongoing project at Limerick, and it's actually very successful. You know, it's hopefully there's going to be a spin-out company that'll emerge from that. But this problem is it is general right across the industry, and it's not just a case of detecting the damage, but as I say, then need to quantify it and decide how important it is. But then, having identified it and quantified it, you then need to be able to repair it. And again, this is an area that we've seen as a potentially a lucrative area for us to be involved in Ireland, where people will pay large amounts of money to get an aeroplane back in the air or to get a wind turbine blade operational again, for the simple reason, as long as once it's not working, it's costing them a lot of money. So there are opportunities to get into this field to provide repair capabilities. So it's something that, again, we have an ongoing activity in IComp to try to gain some advantages, shall we say, in this area for Ireland. So yeah, it's a very, very important area there. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
So this for the benefit of the people who are listening on the web more than us.
This is a question for Terry, really. I do forensic investigations, and every now and again what I find is that I've had a failure of some polymer material, be it a kind of a rubber-like seal or a plastic. Is there anybody I can reach in either Limerick or Athlone that I can have in the polymer? At the moment, I have to send it overseas, and really, I'd much prefer to keep it at home.
Well, I mean, we do have some extremely good analytical and characterization capabilities down in Limerick. We have the so-called Materials and Surface Science Institute, who've got state-of-the-art equipment that can look at all, this is something we do with them all the time, is to look at the structural polymers and the interfaces, shall we say, between the polymer and the filler and the fibre, all those sort of aspects we can look at. We sometimes do projects for our partners who may have, had a change of supplier of one of their filler materials, and they find that their properties are different from what they were getting before, so we can analyse the filler and the surface of the filler and see how it's interacting with the polymer and give them some sort of guidance on how to overcome the problems. So that's the sort of thing that we can do all the time, and they also have a lot of equipment up in and a lot of capability in Limerick in Athlone to do that sort of analysis as well. So it obviously depends on the specific problem, but there's certainly the capability there to be able to help you to do that.
Yeah. In fact, gone are the days that you don't have to go to UK anymore. Yeah. For example, that is true. Yeah. In fact, for example, we do a lot of nearly 30 to 40% of our investigations
or on polymeric materials, yeah, because a lot of our medical device customers' issues are polymeric issues, yeah, and we do that. And if you want a fast turnaround time and a very cost-effective, good value, we stay in Ireland and good for technology. This thing, yeah, and we are there, yeah.
That's a cost. Any other questions out here in the front?
Sorry there, Terry, just in relation to the composite handrail, the use of composites in environments where hygiene is a criteria, we say in medical device companies or hospitals, operating heaters, so on and so forth, how do composites work in those areas, or how do they conform with what's being used now, you know, as a replacement material?
Well, obviously, there's the element of, for example, sterilization, and most composites in that sort of medical area can be, they have sufficient temperature resistance to be sterilizable in, you know, conventional high temperature units and so on. So that's an inherent a requirement when you're choosing materials like that. But I mean, also with some there are some developments where you can actually incorporate biocides, for example, into the surface of the material, so they can then give that sort of have that built-in antimicrobial activity. But I know that within Horizon 2020, there's a big, there's a lot of interest in developing the sort of materials that we're talking about, where you would actually be using much low levels of, for example, silver-based biocides, and trying to achieve this effect through surface, nano topography of the surface and that sort of thing. So there's a lot of scope for developing more advanced materials, shall we say, than there are currently available. But it's something which is it can be a sort of integral part of the composite as you produce it. And you know, we have a company in Mullingar called Taconic, who actually make composite materials for that sort of application, where they actually have built-in biocides in the surface of the product. So yeah, it is done.
I think that's it, is it, in terms of questions? Okay. Yeah. First of all, I just ask you to give a round of thanks to our speakers. Ramesh is driving back to Waterford, and David's driving back to Sligo tonight, so they've made a big effort to come down and come up. And hopefully I'll get to talk to Terry after this. It's one of the functions that we do is to try and disseminate information, so hopefully somebody got an answer to a good question about making use of the facilities that were in the country. And I think that's a big problem that we have, is getting information out there to people so that there is facilities here within the country that can be used. And there's a huge range of activity going on in the country that is available to us. I just want to finish that our next event is on the actual 5th of May coming up, which is Ireland Space Industry. We have three speakers, one from Edmund Williams, who's head of, I think, technology planning in ESA. We have NBio, which is making a material for heat shields for satellites and kind of spacecraft going to the sun. It's the nearest object to the sun. They make the actual space shield. And then we have Moog Ireland, I do believe, who make rocket engines, would you believe, here in Dublin, for positioning satellites. So that's a very high technology kind of set of companies there that are involved. So hopefully you'll be able to come in for that event as well. So anyway, that's the end of the meeting. Thank you for attending, and thanks for those who are online as well. Thank you.